Special task force either at the White House or somewhere that's keeping him informed, or there's a special communications channel set up?
As is always, when there is an event of this nature that occurs anywhere around the world, the White House Situation Room keeps on top of the events. What happened was, as soon as this event occurred, almost simultaneously with the television coverage of it, the Situation Room was informed by NASA and has kept abreast of it with an open line to NASA at the Cape since that time.
Well, I was going to go back again on where the idea of postponing the speech first initiated.
The president initiated the idea of postponing the speech.
Larry, will the shuttle program be suspended at least until the investigation is through?
Those determinations have not been made. The president indicated to Bill Graham that he should find out the cause of it and then proceed. Now, exactly how that dovetails with future flights will just have to be determined as a result of what NASA determines in their investigation.
Consideration of whether any civilians will be permitted to continue on shuttle flights, is that also part of the investigation?
Well, to echo the president's words that all of these people were Americans, they were all interested in space, they all came first with courage, and second, in a spirit of volunteering for this mission. And whether that there'll be any change in that, I don't know. But at the moment, I don't think there's any inclination. Joe?
Has the president attempted to contact the family members of anyone who was on the show?
The president has not yet done that, no. Except to send the vice president in expression of his concern.
Is there any feeling here that NASA was pushing too hard? There was a very ambitious program. Was it 15 launches for this year?
I think NASA has a very good record of safety and a very cautious human approach to space exploration, and they have taken those precautions. This is a tragedy of major proportions and one that concerns us all. But for the moment, there is no finger pointing at NASA as far as their safety record.
If I may, the question arises particularly because in recent launches there have been some glitches that have come up. As you know, they had a problem with the door, the hatch on this, and their drill wouldn't work and all of that. Does that not give the impression that they may be pushing too fast?
I can't make that judgment from here, but I think if you would look back at other space launches in the Mercury and Apollo program, you would find that there have been postponements. These not because of glitches, but because of an extensive safety program that finds these glitches before launch.
Can you be more specific about what the vice president will be doing later today specifically? And also, does the postponement on the State of the Union push back the schedule for the budget and other things that were scheduled for next week?
The vice president's schedule, once he arrives at the Cape, has not been determined, since it's just within the last few moments that the president has asked him to go down.
Well, what's his specific charge?
His charge, once again, is to express the president's concern to the families and to accompany the director of NASA down to the Cape in order to see that that the president's directions for an immediate look into the tragedy, into the explosion, is accomplished.
Is he overseeing an investigation into this?
I don't think that you can say that yet, Norm. I think this matter is entirely in the hands of the NASA people at the present time, and I don't know of any. There's no further planning beyond that. Question on the budget, that has not been determined. It would be my inclination to say that the budget will probably go up on Wednesday, with the State of the Union on Tuesday. I think the Graham-Rudman law requires that it go up by February 5th, and that they will do. Andrea, and then I'm going to go all the way to the back and work forward.
I just want to follow on, Norm. Is it the president's view that perhaps an independent investigation outside of NASA is what is required on the pacing of the program?
Everyone is leapfrogging well ahead of events at present. This tragedy is now only hours old. You have a series of actions taken by the president, including a charge to the director of NASA to find out what happened. And until we do some preliminary studies, none of these questions have answers. So, Pat?
Has the decision been made to have the president officially disclose tonight in his speech what happened, or will we continue to get details from NASA throughout the day, or are they going to hold the president's speech?
NASA will continue to keep you abreast of everything as they know it, as they always have through the entire history of the American space program. So, John?
Larry, you made a point of saying early on that there would be no greater way to honor those who apparently have died in this mission than to continue on with the space program. Is this a deliberate effort to try to counteract any feelings against the program because of the tragedy?
John, the only deliberate effort we're making at the moment is to show our deep concern, our deep emotion, and our desire that America continue in the space program. That's our entire motive, lock, stock, and barrel. Joanne?
Larry, has the president expressed any rue or regret about his proposal to send civilians in space?
The president is obviously concerned about every person that he is the chief executive officer of the government. He is the president directs. He directs people every day, either directly or indirectly, to conduct missions on the part of the government, the military, NASA, and those. It's a fact of life when the man sits in the Oval Office. He has to make these decisions, and I have not heard him express any regret. Concern, yes. Deep emotion, yes. Sorrow, yes. Regret is not... It is not that. It was a decision made, as he said. These individuals are all Americans, and they're all believers in the space program, and that's what's in his mind. So, Walter?
Larry, does the president plan today to speak with any of the relatives, family of any of the...
That hasn't been determined yet, no. Frank?
Can you give us any indication as to what the First Lady was doing at the time that this information became available and what her reaction was?
I don't. We can check with her office, if you will, and see what we can get.
Because the Europeans are able to put up satellites and unmanned vehicles, doesn't this accident argue per se that unmanned vehicles are a preferable way to put up satellites in orbit?
Once again, I have been a silent observer of the space program and not one that's actively involved, and I'm not competent to answer that.
As you recall, the president made the decision to send a teacher into space. Can you tell us on what he based that decision and who suggested the timing and when the time was right for that mission?
Well, Mike, I don't want to come down hard on you, what's in the president's mind right now is to find out what happened and to show those families of those people that he's concerned. And that's all that's on his mind at the moment.
Are you operating on the assumption that this is the result of some technological problem, and or has anyone suggested the possibility it might be an act of terrorism?
There have been no suggestions either way.
Thank you.
This was, of course, this disastrous accident this morning, the first in-air disaster or fatal accident that NASA has experienced. It's the only other time when astronauts have been killed as part of a space program was actually on the ground back in 1967 on a launch pad explosion as part of the Apollo program. Three astronauts died in that accident after 16 previous successful missions: Lieutenant Colonel Virgil Grissom, Lieutenant Colonel Edward White, and Lieutenant Commander Roger Chaffee were all killed on Apollo flight. It was flight 204. One of the people who witnessed that and was taking a careful notice of same is Robert Wessler, who is an executive here with Turner Broadcasting and working for another network formerly. In January of 1967 was the executive producer of Special Events and was covering this as it happened. Can you tell us the reaction at the time back in 1967 to the tragedy?
Well, Marianne, it was a different time, it was a different age. The individual astronauts, there were only 15 or 18 at the time, active astronauts, the original seven, of whom two were not flying at the time, and a second class of, I believe, about 12, from which Roger Chaffee and Ed White had come from. The public was much more familiar with them. It was truly, there's a good picture of Gus Grissom right now. Ed White, the first man to walk in space for this country, Roger Chaffee right there, the rookie on the flight. Scenes of their memorable funeral procession in Washington and at Arlington National Cemetery. Scenes that I remember quite well. A different time because the individual astronauts were known so much more, so much better than, of course, the astronauts of today. There were fewer of them. There were fewer flights. Each one was a major newsworthy event of its time. The news of the accident on the pad at Cape Canaveral on that historic Friday, last week in January, almost the same date of today, 19 years ago, spread like wildfire among the news media throughout Cocoa Beach, Florida, Cape Canaveral, and the New York Network news centers. At that time, in the NASA space program, there was very heavy security throughout the Cape Canaveral Center, Cape Kennedy, there were no newsmen on the Cape at the time of the accident. The accident took place about 6:30 at night. We began to hear that there were problems sometime around 7 o'clock or 7:30, and it was not until about 8 p.m. at night that NASA finally made an announcement that there had been an accident. To the best of our knowledge, the three astronauts at the time were killed instantly. Fortunately or unfortunately, I was taken to the pad area about 7 days after the accident, and it is still one of the more horrific memories of my days as a newsman.
We have been getting to know all through this morning and early this afternoon the seven crew members aboard the Challenger who are believed to have been killed in this terrible accident. Can you tell us something about these three astronauts?
Well, of course,
who were the first to be killed in it?
Certainly. I think Gus Grissom was well portrayed in the motion picture The Right Stuff, which was, of course, about the lives of the seven original astronauts, the Mercury astronauts, as they were referred to. The famous Life magazine photograph when they were announced back in the late 50s and their progress towards a manned launching in 1961. Alan Shepard was our first astronaut in space for the United States, that having come on May the 3rd, 1951. Gus Grissom was our second astronaut. He went into space, I believe the date was a mid-July date in 1961. He had some problems on that flight. A spacecraft problem happened after his suborbital flight, and a helicopter came along to pick he and his capsule up. It flooded with water. The capsule was lost. Grissom was saved. And there were investigations after the fact as to exactly what happened. Nothing was ever proven or disproven with regard to why that capsule was lost. Ed White, a very popular astronaut, our first walker in space on a Gemini flight in June of 1965, and Roger Chaffee regarded to be one of the brightest of the young astronauts. There was probably a very good chance that those two astronauts would have gone to the moon, certainly on Apollo 11, our first flight, or shortly thereafter. Three very popular astronauts. It delayed the space program at the time for some 12 or 18 months until we finally got back on the road in 1968 and culminating with a successful lunar landing in July of 1969.
And again, NASA saying today that it could be months before another space shuttle will be able to be launched because of until they figure out exactly what happened.
Well, certainly it's going to take a long time to investigate the difficulties of today.
Thank you very much. Robert Wessler was the executive producer of special events for CBS when the accident occurred, killing our astronauts in 1967. Bob?
Marianne, among the people watching the launch, preparations for it, and then the launch itself at Kennedy Space Center this morning, first with tremendous pride and excitement, and then in absolute disbelieving horror, were Mr. and Mrs. Edward Corrigan, Edward and Grace Corrigan, the parents of Krista Corrigan McAuliffe, who was just about to become this country's and the world's first teacher in space. It was just last month that Mr. and Mrs. Corrigan spoke with our correspondent, Tony Clark.
What was it like when Krista was selected? How do you all feel?
Great.
Excited. Very excited.
You all going to be at the Cape?
Naturally, we wouldn't miss it.
Yes, the whole family will be there. We have four other children besides Krista, so everybody will be there.
is this really like her? I mean, is...
what, yes. Absolutely.
Let me do this one at a time. Ms. Corbett, did it surprise you, first, that she would try to be an astronaut and then be selected?
No, on both. I know an awful lot of luck was involved in it, but I'm not surprised because I knew she'd do a good job if she were chosen, and I'm just so pleased that she was chosen.
Yeah. What's she like growing up?
The same as she is as she comes over now. Exactly the same. She hasn't really changed.
But to people that don't know her and all they know is just what they've seen on TV, how would you describe your daughter, the teacher astronaut?
Oh, very caring, outgoing, excited, interested.
I would think, as father, this is just, I mean, you just got to be really proud.
Yes, absolutely proud.
What do you hope that she gets out of this, or is able to give others out of this? Mm-hmm. Is there something that she can pass on to others? Or?
Well, I think that we hope the same as what she's hoping to bring back when she talks about demystifying space, and to come back and let all the other people know that it's not just scientists up there, that for the future everybody will be into space. And I think that's what she hopes to bring back to her children and to the teachers and to everybody in general.
How has she been just in talking to you all about the training and everything?
Totally excited. I mean, she never goes down low about anything. She's truly right with it all the time. She loves what she's doing. No complaints. But she's got that kind of a disposition anyway. She doesn't complain.
I imagine you all are looking forward to that point where she comes back and just tells you everything.
Yes. And to have her back, too.
Edward Corrigan, the Commander-in-Chief, President Reagan at the White House, learned about this tragedy. He was in his office, in the Oval Office, and he was preparing to meet with a group of reporters and network anchormen, myself included. We were waiting in the Roosevelt Room, and we didn't notice when Donald Reagan, the chief of staff, got up and left the room, and we didn't notice a few other things, but we learned later that Vice President George Bush and the National Security Advisor, Admiral John Poindexter, who was sitting two seats to my right at the table in the Roosevelt Room, he slipped out. Charles Bierbauer, you're there at the Northwest Lawn of the White House. You were in the room, and you can tell us more.
Well, Bernie, at that point, we heard the president, of course, expressed his horror, his concern at the tragedy that he had, in fact, himself seen unfold, watching a replay on the television. It was just at that point that we found out that what had happened, and the president found out about it at the same time. When the president did come in and talk with us, you recall, he said that he thought he would go ahead with the State of the Union address as scheduled this evening. In fact, in the draft, there had been a reference to the space program and the fact that the shuttle was up in space, sort of part of the president's look forward to the 21st century. He indicated, as he spoke with us, that he would certainly make reference to this tragedy into the State of the Union address tonight, and he felt that it was important to let people know that life goes on. However, in the span of the next hour, the president had some second thoughts, obviously, about that. He's canceled the State of the Union address after consultation with leaders on Capitol Hill, the feeling it was better to put it off for a week. He'll make the State of the Union address next Tuesday night rather than tonight. And White House spokesman Larry Speaks explained what went through the president's mind, why in that span of an hour he changed his mind.
Like all Americans, watched this on television, and he felt very keenly the emotion that must be felt by the families of those down there and that had to watch this event in person, and very keenly what the American people must be feeling. He consulted with the congressional leadership, and the consensus opinion of the executive and the legislative branch was that it was appropriate to postpone.
Larry, so, can you tell us what information the president is getting other than from television at this point?
Well, as I just said, the president has conferred with the director of NASA, and he brought him up to date, providing him with as much information as he can. There is not an extensive body of information at the moment that exists. NASA is looking into it as quickly as they can, and as I say, a search mission goes on.
Is there a special task force either at the White House or somewhere that's keeping him informed, or are there special communications channels set up?
As is always, when there is an event of this nature that occurs anywhere around the world, the White House Situation Room keeps on top of the events. What happened was, as soon as this event occurred, almost simultaneously with the television coverage of it, the Situation Room was informed by NASA and has kept abreast of it with an open line to NASA at the Cape since that time.
The president will speak to the nation tonight on television about the shuttle tragedy. He has sent Vice President Bush and the director of NASA down to Florida to get together with people down there to find out just what has happened, to convey the president's sincere sympathies to the families of the astronauts who were involved. White House spokesman Larry Speaks called this a tragedy of major proportion, but said that there is no finger pointing at NASA in any sense, that the safety record of NASA has been remarkable up to this point. He said indeed that the president's only concern right now is to find out what has happened, to express his concern, and that's the primary thought on the president's mind at this point. One other note, First Lady Nancy Reagan was also watching television this morning when the tragedy occurred. Her remarks, as conveyed by her, the First Lady's press office, were that it's time we should start praying that there is some thread of hope. And while the White House will not say and is not in a position to describe the fate of the seven astronauts, there is really very little hope here. Bernie?
Thank you, Charles. Charles Bierbauer reporting live from the White House. Joining us now at Newsday, John Logsdon with the Science Policy Program at George Washington University here in the nation's capital. Your thoughts, sir?
Well, we've been taking risks in front of the world really since Alan Shepard's flight in May of 1961. Even at that point, when the first American was going to go into space, there was a major debate of whether to do it live in front of a camera. And the decision then was, yes, that was the kind of program we were going to have, recognizing the risks. The risks now have arrived. Unlike the Soviets, who only announced their manned flights after they're successful, we do this as a sense of common accomplishment, recognizing the risks. Unfortunately, the risks occurred.
That's an interesting point. At that briefing in the Roosevelt Room, President Reagan, he came in and he talked to us for about 12 minutes, a little over, 75 minutes ago. And I asked the president, I said, philosophically, Mr. Reagan, do you take any solace in the fact that the U.S. space program, as we know it, has been safer than the Soviets, that the Soviets have lost many more people? And President Reagan looked down the table at me and he said, quote, it's something to cling to right now, but it doesn't lessen the grief, unquote.
No, not at all. This is a risky business yet. We're on the edges of human exploration and human achievement. We're taking the kind of risks required to do exciting, adventurous, and valuable things. Everybody that was involved in this, from Krista McAuliffe to Commander Scobie, knew quite well that it was a risk and were willing to undertake that risk.
Also today, Mr. Reagan underscored that a reporter asked him how he felt about the fact that the teacher was on board, and President sort of said, in fact, he said, it's the last frontier. Those were his words.
Indeed. I think the identification of the public with the fact that one of them, an ordinary citizen, happened to be aboard this mission, not the 24 that went before it, I think broadens the tragedy and therefore is bad luck is understating it by several orders of magnitude. There were six others who had dedicated their careers to the shuttle program on this, and their loss for the program is equally as great. For the country, I guess the identification is with Krista, though.
Have you any fear whatsoever that NASA's outstanding record with safety and achievement will be lost in the wake of a backlash because of this tragedy?
I hope not. That would be totally irrational behavior. This country is capable of behaving irrationally in crisis situations, and I think Mr. Reagan has said that what is needed now is to find out what happened, fix it, and go ahead with the program, and that's exactly the right response, that there are too many things worth doing that the people that were on this mission had dedicated themselves to to stop, to say it's not worth doing, that because of this accident the program will not go ahead, would be, among other things, a tragedy for those that were involved in this accident.
What about our national sense of presumption? We Americans over the past decade or so became so attuned to the space program operating functionally very well, being well-funded, safety being way up there. It's almost as if we've taken this very dangerous program for granted. We never had tragedies per se, except the ones that we've been reporting on prior to this one today. And it's as if we didn't watch these launches after a couple of years because they were so routine. I suppose maybe we should have been reminded with each launch that this is very dangerous and we're very fortunate.
Well, but it is supposed to be routine. That's the idea of the program now, is that each launch is not an adventure. Of course it is for the individuals involved. So is driving to work in the morning or getting on a 747. The necessity is making sure the resources, the people, the funding to assure constant safety is available. To shortcut the program would enhance the chance of something like this happening.
Certainly there will be a full-scale, full-court press kind of investigation, but based on the videotapes you've seen, based on what you know about this vehicle, what's your hunch as to what happened?
Well, first of all, I haven't seen the videotapes, and I'm not sure I want to, since I wasn't exposed to them in the first place. I think it's almost irresponsible to begin to say, well, it was external tank rupturing, or because it was cold, or some of the other things that I've heard already. The people who are close in, who have the data, are the people that ought to say what happened. There's, of course, a pressing curiosity, but there's not much we can do about it. And I think it's, as I say, almost irresponsible for those not close to the technical character of what went on to be running around talking about what happened.
Your reservation is appreciated. John Logsdon with the Science Policy Program at George Washington University here in the nation's capital.
Thank you.
Now, let's go to our man in Atlanta, Tom Mintier. Tom?
Thank you, Bernie. For those who may be just joining us, let's turn the clock back a few hours now and take you to a replay from the Kennedy Space Center just a few moments before Challenger lifted off at 11:39 after several hours of delay because of ice problems on the structure surrounding the shuttle. They sent a crew of 8 men out to knock that ice off. Main engines have started here. It appeared everything was normal.
And liftoff of the 25th Space Shuttle mission, and it has cleared the tower.
Roger, roll, Challenger.
The roll maneuver taking place. Everything still looked normal about 20 seconds into flight. This is the VIP viewing area, taking pictures as they normally do every time there is a shuttle flight. Everything appeared normal here.
Velocity 2,257 feet per second. Altitude 4.3 nautical miles. Downrange distance 3 nautical miles.
In a second, they were ordered to throttle up. And then the last words from the shuttle.
Throttling up. 3 engines now at 104%.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Roger, go at throttle up.
Seconds. Velocity 2,900 feet per second. Altitude 9 nautical miles. Downrange distance 7 nautical miles.
Huge ball of fire in the solid rockets veering out of control. One went left and then curved. Here's the slow motion replay. You see a fire between the shuttle and the external tank. And then an explosion right at the point where the shuttle and the tank are connected, and a huge fireball. recovery efforts. Here are the spectators watching as the shuttle cleared the pad. There is Krista McAuliffe's parents, Ed and Grace Corrigan. They were told by a NASA official, walked up to them and said the vehicle had exploded. Mrs. Corrigan, stunned, looked back at him and repeated his words as a question. The vehicle has exploded. And then they were led away. Let's go now to Bernie Shaw in Washington. Bernie?
Thank you, Tom. The chairman of the Senate Budget Committee, Senator Pete Domenici of New Mexico, is in the Senate Radio TV Gallery. Let's listen in.
Very human, wonderful people. The experts, the astronauts are very marvelous aviators and technical people. They did their share. Something just happened, and we don't know what it is yet.
Senator, okay. Did you see the explosion, and what was your first reaction?
Yeah, it was purely accidental. I came back from the White House, was sitting behind my desk doing some other work, and a staffer walked in and said, it blew up. And I said, what blew up? And he said, the space shuttle. I said, on the ground, no, in space. We turned on the TV, and there they were replaying it. So I was not watching it live, but it was just the same as if it was live, because I'd heard very little before, maybe 40 seconds. As it did that, I really couldn't believe that it was happening. I kept looking for something to come out the other end, and it didn't. It was a rather amazing sight for me, and in fact, I thought maybe it was something else for a while. Okay?
Thank you all very much.
All right. Members of the 99th Congress still reacting to this tragedy. You've often heard the word redundancy in our space systems. Lots of safety precautions taken, lots of safety procedures involved, escape procedures. Tom Mintier tells us about it.
Bernie, there used to be ejection seats that had parachutes on the space shuttle. Recently, as the program advanced and they had more and more shuttles online, they removed those seats to allow more room for scientific experiments and other things to be in the space shuttle. The investigation, of course, is going to go on for a long, long time, barely just getting started now. All really that NASA has right now to work with is some of the data that was going on for that first 1 minute in space that was sent down by downlink dish from the Challenger into their recording banks. They say they have secured all of that information, and they, of course, will be going over it. There is a contingency plan when something goes wrong on the space shuttle. It's something that the people at NASA never really talked too much about. The last time was when we had the engines of the shuttle shut down on the pad last summer, and then people started asking the questions, what would happen if something went wrong? Here is a freeze frame of where it appears a fire broke out between the external tank and the space shuttle. In a diagram, you can see how the external tank is connected in several places to the shuttle. Here, in this book, shows two areas where explosive charges are placed by NASA, in that point and in that point. There is also a propellant line that runs down here to supply the shuttle's main engines. Now, not saying that the craft was triggered from the ground, but that contingency exists. If the shuttle had veered way off course, a range officer at Cape Canaveral Air Force Base could have thrown a switch that would have sent an encrypted signal to the shuttle to blow it up. It is a contingency plan that NASA has on its books. But it appeared from the video and from everything we know so far that the shuttle was not veering wildly off course, that it was continuing downrange to a point about 9 miles. Of course, the investigation is just getting started, and it may take months or even years to know what happened because so little will be left. Lou?
All right, Tom. And CNN's live coverage of this morning's tragedy at the Kennedy Space Center will continue throughout the day and night. The next major event we're anticipating is a briefing at the National Aeronautics and Space Administration at 3:30 Eastern Time. That's in a little less than an hour. At that time, we hope to learn more about the search and recovery efforts now going on off the coast of Florida. Michael J. Smith was the Navy commander who was piloting the space shuttle this morning when it exploded just about a minute after liftoff. With us now is CNN's own Nick Gregory, our meteorologist who was once accepted at the Huntsville, Alabama Space and Rocket Center in the simulation program, and you sat in the seat in the simulator that Michael Smith, the pilot of the Challenger flight this morning, was sitting in. Elucidate about what happens there.
Well, the pilot's responsibility, Lou, is, again, as pilot of the mission, he is responsible for flying the mission. The commander is in charge of the entire mission. The pilot, during launch, monitors all the information systems, monitors the engine performance. As we were hearing in the playback from NASA, when the command is given, go at throttle up. He is the one responsible for monitoring that the computer is handling the throttle-up procedures. Now, this is a simulator, almost the size of the same simulator that I went through. This is at the Johnson Space Flight Center in Houston, the exact simulator that all of them train on, and it is very important to keep in mind that space travel, the way we know it today, on the Challenger or on Discovery, on all of our shuttles, could not be made possible unless you were to try to go through it in a space simulator, because they are throwing at you all the emergency procedures through it. Now we're looking at video of the Challenger crew as they were training for their mission. Mike Smith leading the way at the top of the stairs there, again entering the orbiter, which is put in a launch position. It's simulated there as a liftoff position. They are going to practice getting into the orbiter as they would on the launch pad, putting on their helmets and their harnesses, which they need. There's Krista McAuliffe. Again, as she prepares herself to get into the orbiter, we do the same kind of simulation that they would do over there at the Johnson Space Flight Center. I was experiencing the same kind of activity you see here, preparing to go into the orbiter, then strapping in for liftoff. Then they threw a few emergencies at our crew, and once you're on board the orbiter, you must look at possibilities of, again, for an emergency. Is there going to be a return to the landing site? Will there be a transatlantic abort? They do have what is called an emergency egress procedure, where if something were to happen on the pad, they can quickly open the hatch, and they have these escape modules waiting on the launch pad area that they hop into and essentially steer them off to safety down this long rope that takes them off to a safe area away from the launch pad. Now, once you get into liftoff, again, the first 2 minutes of the flight where you're with the solid rocket boosters, there's really not much you can do if an emergency occurs except to go away from the main engine, go away from the solid rocket pack that you have, and to go away from the liquid and hydrogen fuel cell. Now, this was today's crew as they were training. Again, you can see Krista McAuliffe getting ready to go into the orbiter as she would board the orbiter normally, and then they will strap themselves in for a simulated launch. And believe me, the simulations are quite realistic. They simulate the entire thing for you.
The last words from the space shuttle this morning, Nick, full throttle up. What was happening at that stage?
At that point, the orbiter is passing through, or just had passed through, what is called max Q, which is an area where the most aerodynamic pressure is being experienced by the orbiter as it goes up towards space travel. So the command is given just before that for the pilot, or actually the computer, let's say, with the pilot monitoring the system, to throttle back. And they throttle back to about 65%, not to allow, again, the pressure to build up on the orbiter. Once they pass through the area, the word from mission control is orbiter your go at throttle up, and then the computer throttles back to 104% maximum thrust, and the pilot acknowledges that the orbiter is doing just that.
Are you familiar with the evolution of the space shuttle program from the time when Columbia had the ejection seats to this flight of the Challenger, which had no means of escape for the astronauts?
Yes, I am. The Columbia, when it was using as a test shuttle, let's say, the first few missions that were just test shuttles, they had it equipped with ejection seats. Once they proved, again, that they felt it was safe, they took the ejection seats out to allow more seats to be placed into the orbiter, because the ejection seats are so big, they cannot allow more seats into the orbiter for the other crew members. Like in this case, we had 7 crew members, so that would just not be possible with ejection seats.
All right, Nick Gregory, and now to Lee Green, who's on the line from Concord, New Hampshire. He's at the Concord High School, the school at which Krista McAuliffe taught, and where students this morning were watching the horror on television just a minute after liftoff. Lee, what's happening there?
Well, to sum it up in a couple of words, Lou, as you can imagine, stunned disbelief in this Miss McAuliffe's home. She was a very popular woman around here who taught at Concord High School, where, as you mentioned, the students were watching on television this morning. They were sent home just over an hour ago, many of them in tears, the look of shock very evident on their faces, we understand. It never occurred to most of the students that anything could go wrong with the shuttle. It's been such a smooth program up till now. At the very most, they'd expressed some impatience over the series of delays that plagued this particular shuttle. Many don't know what to make of the thing so far. We heard one interviewed, one student saying that he's changed his plans to get into the space program. It certainly put him off the whole thing. Krista McAuliffe's immediate family, including her husband and parents, are at the Cape, and they've been taken away by NASA officials. They apparently were unaware right at the beginning what had happened and didn't know that there had been this disaster until they were informed by NASA officials. Krista McAuliffe had planned to keep a diary in the air and to try and express the common person's point of view of space flight. She's going to be very much missed in Concord, and certainly that record is a loss to the world. But
Lee, can you describe that moment in the classroom earlier this morning when we understand that reporters and cameramen were asked to leave?
I wish I could, Lou. I wasn't there. We've only just made it into Concord, but it was not a very pleasant scene from what we're hearing about it. There was a great deal of shock and disbelief, as I'm saying, and it was quite a trauma for the students who, as I say, were sent home shortly after that.
Well, how many students were involved, you know? Was this a school-wide...
The whole school would have been watching this morning, and they had planned, of course, to watch... prior to this, and it's rather disrupted the school schedule. So the entire school would have been watching, and what we're hearing from there is that it's a very unhappy scene, as you can imagine.
All right. Lee Green in Concord, New Hampshire at the Concord High School, the school at which Krista McAuliffe, one of the seven astronauts aboard the Space Shuttle Challenger, who died this morning about a minute after liftoff from the Kennedy Space Center. It was the first in-flight disaster in 56 U.S. manned space missions, and we're still gathering information on it. We'll have a NASA briefing in about 47 minutes. Both the United States and Soviet Union have had serious setbacks as they've explored space over the past quarter century. Some astronauts have died before, and CNN's Bill McGowan has a report on that.
Tragedy struck once before in the U.S. space program. In 1967, three astronauts were killed when fire swept through their Apollo spacecraft as it was being tested on the launch pad at Cape Canaveral. The deaths of Gus Grissom, Edward White, and Roger Chaffee are the only fatalities on board a spacecraft in the U.S. space program. That fire apparently started when an electrical spark ignited the oxygen-rich atmosphere in the spacecraft. The tragedy delayed the Apollo program for nearly 2 years while safety features were added. The Soviets were first in space with Sputnik in 1957 and first with a man in space with Yuri Gagarin's 1961 Earth orbit. They too have paid a cost in human life. A cosmonaut was killed during a 1967 space flight when the craft's parachute failed to open on returning to Earth. In 1971, three Soviet cosmonauts were found dead in their returned spacecraft after 24 days in orbit. Despite spectacular achievements like landing men on the moon, America's space effort has been plagued with technical problems from its earliest days. The space shuttle program has had its share of technical troubles. The shuttle Challenger has had earlier flights aborted because of fuel contamination, and one of its missions was cut short when an engine shut down in flight. The frequent launch postponements underline NASA's concern for safety factors, but today's tragedy emphasizes that human ingenuity cannot eliminate the element of danger from the exploration of space. Bill McGowan, CNN.
A member of the Senate Science and Transportation Committee, Republican Larry Pressler of South Dakota, is in the Senate Radio TV Gallery. He has some thoughts about today's tragedy.
We have to protect them. We have to continue to explore this area in terms of national defense, as well as exploring the efficient movement of people.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Senator Pressler, joining others of his colleagues who've come forward to express themselves, not just as members of this Congress, but also as Americans grieving the loss of the Americans who presumably were lost in today's tragedy involving the shuttle mission. Your network of record will continue its live coverage of developments as they come up. We're expecting here from Washington at 3:30 p.m. Eastern Time this afternoon a briefing at the NASA building on what the latest is. As you know, Vice President George Bush is traveling down to Florida, to the Cape, to be with the families. And President Reagan now has delayed the State of the Union address because of what has happened, put it off for a week. Larry Speaks says the president indeed does feel exactly what you, I, all Americans, and all persons around this planet are feeling. Back to Tom Mintier now in Atlanta. Tom?
Bernie, as you were saying, the investigation will probably take months or even years to complete. The recovery efforts that were launched in the area of Cape Canaveral Air Force Base, a C-130 and several ships, including a Coast Guard cutter, moved into the area, but it was at least 55 minutes before they could move into the impact area, which was estimated to be about 9 miles downrange. NASA says the reason they were not able to move in any sooner than that was the fact that the debris from Challenger was still falling from the sky. We saw in our live pictures several pieces of large chunks that were falling down either from the external tank or from Challenger itself. Challenger has had problems before, technical problems before. Back in July, it aborted a launch with just seconds left when a computer detected a problem with one of the fuel lines and aborted the launch. About 17 days later, Challenger did blast off, but about 5 minutes and 15 seconds into the flight, a monitoring sensor on board Challenger reported overheating in one of the shuttle's main engines. And for the first time in the space program's history, an engine was shut down in flight. They were able to continue that flight on into a lower than expected orbit and able to continue on with their mission as scheduled. It went into that lower orbit with the remaining two engines simply by running them a little longer than expected. For those of you who may be just joining us, the accident occurred about 1 minute after liftoff from the Kennedy Space Center. There had been several delays throughout the morning because of concern about ice. Ice from freezing temperatures, it went down below freezing late last night, and there was concern as far back as Sunday about the cold temperatures that they would be launching under. They sent a crew out to the pad area about a half an hour before they launched to clean off some ice. 2-foot icicles were hanging from the structure that surrounds the space shuttle, and they went out and knocked those icicles off. They had an emergency meeting just prior to that when they decided that it would not cause a problem if there was ice on those structures. They decided by going out and taking them off that they could go ahead and proceed with the count. Yesterday, of course, they did not go because of winds at the landing area, the 3-mile runway at the Kennedy Space Center that would have been used had there not been an explosion. If the external tank had simply separated from the shuttle, they were able to then glide back to the area. They have several areas that they can glide to. At the earliest point, it is the 3-mile runway at the Kennedy Space Center, and then after a little farther in powered flight, it is a transatlantic abort site over in Spain and a new one established in Morocco. But 1 minute into the flight, a red, huge ball of fire and smoke erupted around the shuttle, and then there was nothing left. Lou?
Okay, Tom. It could be pointed out that this shuttle, Challenger, that exploded today has had troubles before. In July of last year, just before launch, a computer detected contamination in Challenger's hydrogen fuel and aborted that launch. 17 days later, Challenger blasted off, but 5 minutes and 15 seconds into that flight, a monitoring device reported overheating in one of the main engines. And for the first time in history of the space program, an engine was shut down in flight before the shuttle Challenger reached its orbit. The pictures are horrifying. A feeling of disbelief when they were first shown live this morning here on CNN. We'll show them to you again, beginning just before liftoff at the Kennedy Space Center in Florida.
Started.
T-minus 21 seconds, and the solid rocket booster engine gimbal now underway. T-minus 15 seconds. T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. We have main engine start, 4, 3, 2, 1, and liftoff. Liftoff of the 25th Space Shuttle mission, and it has cleared the tower.
Roger, roll, Challenger. Good, roll program confirmed. Challenger now heading downrange. Engines beginning throttling down now at 94%. Normal throttles for most of the flight, 104%. We'll throttle down to 65% shortly. Engines at 65%, three engines running normally, three good fuel cells, three good APUs. Velocity, 2,257 feet per second. Altitude, 4.3 nautical miles. Downrange distance, 3 nautical miles. Engines throttling up. Three engines now at 104%.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Minute 15 seconds. Velocity 2,900 feet per second. Altitude 9 nautical miles. Downrange distance 7 nautical miles.
We will report more as we have information available.
Those who apparently died this morning aboard the 25th shuttle mission, Francis R. Dick Scobie, spacecraft commander. He was born May 19, 1939 in Washington State. He became a NASA astronaut in 1978, received a B.S. degree in aerospace engineering from the University of Arizona in 1965. Judith Resnick was a Ph.D. She was one of the three mission specialists aboard this flight. She was born April 5th, 1949 in Akron, Ohio. She received a B.S. degree in electrical engineering from Carnegie Mellon University and a Ph.D. in electrical engineering from the University of Maryland. She became an astronaut in 1978. There was Sharon Krista McAuliffe, who is a teacher from Concord, New Hampshire. She was selected as the first citizen in space for the NASA Teacher in Space Project in July of 85. Krista, as she liked to be called, was born September 2, 1948 in Boston. She received a BA degree from Framingham State College and a master's degree in education from Bowie State College in Bowie, Maryland. Ellison Onizuki was on board, Lieutenant Colonel in the United States Air Force. He was a mission specialist. He became an astronaut in 1978, born June 24, 1946 in Hawaii. He received a B.S. and M.S. degrees in aerospace engineering from the University of Colorado. He became a NASA astronaut in 1978. Gregory B. Jarvis, a payload specialist, a laser specialist, was on board. He was born August 24, 1944, in Detroit. He received a B.S. degree in electrical engineering from the State University of New York at Buffalo, an M.S. degree in electrical engineering from Northeastern University in Boston. Ronald E. McNair, a Ph.D., mission specialist, became an astronaut in the class of 1978. He was born October 21st, 1950 in Lake City, South Carolina. He received a B.S. degree in physics from North Carolina, A&T State University, and a Ph.D. in physics from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Those were the people aboard the space shuttle this morning. Joining us on the line now from the Kennedy Space Center, CNN's John Zarella. John, update on recovery efforts.
Yes, Lou, I was just informed just a few moments ago that the recovery vehicles, this comes from Lieutenant Colonel Robert Nicholson of the Department of Defense, that the recovery vehicles have spotted some floating debris, including what appears to be a piece of debris with a parachute on it. Now, of course, he says that to qualify that, of course, that could be part of the SRB, the solid rocket booster, which would have returned to Earth with the parachute, those reusable boosters. There is still no word on the orbiter's location, if indeed any parts of the orbiter are still intact. The swells in the Atlantic are running 15 to 18 feet. Visibility is very low out there at the site of the recovery operation, so helicopters have now been sent back to Patrick Air Force Base to wait for the low cloud cover to clear. But again, just to update you, they have identified pieces of floating debris, one of which appears to have a parachute attached to it. Lou?
All right, John Zarella at the Kennedy Space Center, we'll be in touch with you. Again, floating debris has been spotted by the recovery teams now working off the Kennedy Space Center. Science correspondent Tom Mentier now.
Lou, the NASA's ambitious schedule of 15 missions this year, there have been problems from the start, starting in December of last year. That was when Columbia was scheduled to lift off from the Kennedy Space Center. It didn't leave until 1986. And there were problems with the weather, problems with the mechanics, and then the problems really rubbed off into Challenger as it waited while Columbia circled trying to find a place to land. They tried to bring it back to the Kennedy Space Center, but were unable to because of